إليك السبيل إذا ضللتا وتحمل منه في ناديك تاجا ويكسوك الجمال إذا عريتا ينالك نفعه ما دمت حيا ويبقى ذكره لك إن ذهبتا هو العضب المهند ليس ينبو تصيب به مقاتل من أردتا وكنز لا تخاف عليه لصا خفيف الحمل يوجد.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأزواجه أمهات المؤمنين وعلى من اتبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. My dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam, I hope we can hear you, you can hear me. Is it better? Inshallah, the sound is better. Any better? The sound any better? Just let me know. Inshallah, we'll fix it. Bismillah ta'ala. We'll see here what's going on with the sound. Let me see. عليكم ورحمة الله. What about now? Can you hear me now, inshallah? Can you hear me now? Please let me know if you can hear me. I can see your lips moving, but no sound. Okay. What about now? Okay, you can hear me well now? Okay. Alhamdulillah. Is the sound okay so? Sound is doing okay? So the sound is good. طيب الحمد لله. طيب الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. I want to say رمضان مبارك to all of you, dear respected brothers and sisters in Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept from all of us, Ya Rabb al-Alameen. Tonight is the first night of Taraweeh. Tomorrow is the first day of fasting, inshallah. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept us, Ya Rabb al-Alameen, and make us amongst those who will receive forgiveness during this month of Ramadan. Today, inshallah, we will have Taraweeh right after Isha. And I want to remind the brothers and the sisters in Islam that man sama Ramadan imanan wa ihtisaba غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه، ومن قام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه، ومن قام ليلة القدر إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Imagine so many opportunities in Ramadan, fasting the month, إيمانا واحتسابا, sins by the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be forgiven. Secondly is observing قيام إيمانا واحتسابا. Again, these are the prerequisites that you believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mandated upon you to do that. إيمانا واحتسابا, sins can be forgiven. And finally, Laylatul Qadr. Brothers and sisters in Islam, be keen on attending Taraweeh with the Imam in the Masjid. It will be something good, inshaAllah. Today we have the Right Belief series, that is volume 2, which we decided to respond to the grave worshippers regarding their claim that grave worshipping is not shirk. And this is what I have for you today, inshallah, brothers and sisters in Islam, the Right Belief series, right here. We called it La Ilaha Illallah, Worship Your Lord. This is the title. The brother is asking about streaming Taraweeh. Yes, inshallah, I think they are planning to do that, inshallah, bi-ithnillah. Today, brothers and sisters in Islam, is lecture number 4. That is lecture 1 here. How come? Okay, let me see here. Where is 4? Where is 4? Where is 4? Okay. Maybe you got the wrong one there. Okay. Okay, we need to get lecture number 4 somehow. That is 3, okay. Okay, that is lecture number 4 right here, brothers and sisters in Islam. Grave worshipping is the ultimate injustice a person may commit during his life. What do we mean by that? The question which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhu, Ya Mu'adh, O Mu'adh, atadri حق الله على العباد, do you know the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon his slaves? Mu'adh answered by saying, Allah wa rasuluhu a'lam, Allah and his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger know best. The Prophet said, أن تعبد الله ولا تشرك به شيئا, that you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you associate no one in worship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Mu'adh asked, the Prophet asked Mu'adh a second question, and what is the right of the people upon Allah? And you know, Mu'tazila unfortunately took that statement out of context. They actually established one of their belief systems that Allah has to do what is right for the people. Really, what the Prophet mentioned here or referring to, that the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised to do something, he will deliver it. That is what the Prophet is saying. That if we worship him alone without any partners, without any associates, Allah will admit us into Jannah. So this is one hadith. The second hadith, Hadith ibn Mas'ud, أي الظلم أعظم؟ What is the most awful, the most terrible, the most heinous form of shirk, form of injustice a person may commit in his life? أي الظلم أعظم؟ أن تجعل لله ندا وهو خلقك. That you appoint a rival against Allah or an associate with Allah when Allah is the one who created you. خلقك من لا شيء من عدم وأمدك بكل شيء. He created you from nothing and he provided you with everything that you have, and you go and you invoke, call upon someone else, showing humility, showing humbleness to a created being like you who needs Allah as well. Not only that, he is dead, is underneath the ground. What is wrong with you? That is why it's a form of dhulm, brothers and sisters in Islam. When this verse was recited, I believe verse 82, chapter 6, Al-An'am, فَأَيُّ الْفَرِيقَيْنِ أَحَقُّ بِالْأَمْنِ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. Which of the two, the context of the verses before it, we're talking about disbelievers and believers. They are debating. They are doing muhajja. Everyone is presenting his hujja, his evidence, his proof. At the end, Allah is saying on the tongue of Ibrahim alayhi salam, because Ibrahim was presenting the believers in this debate, فَأَيُّ الْفَرِيقَيْنِ أَحَقُّ بِالْأَمْنِ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. Which of the two, the believers or the disbelievers, worthy or are entitled to security, to the feeling of security on the day of judgment, if you know? The answer came in verse 82. Read it with me. الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَلَمْ يَلْبِسُوا إِيمَانَهُمْ بِظُلْمٍ أُولَٰئِكَ لَهُمُ الْأَمْنُ وَهُمْ مُهْتَدُونَ. Those who believe, those who say لَا إِلَٰهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ مُحَمَّدٌ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ, but they do not tarnish their iman, their tawheed, with injustice. Pay attention to this verse, because this verse is a key. Of course, there is a rule. An Arab who speaks Arabic, not the Arabs of today, someone who studied the Arabic language would tell you, النكرة في سياق النفي تفيد العموم. When you have a noun which is not connected with the al, which is equals the in English, we call it indefinite, nakira, not defined. Not defined, nakira, something nakira. Zulm. Zulm. Alladhina amanu wa lam yalbisu imanahum bi zulm. Is not a zulm. No. Zulm. Now, and the sentence is negated, then any injustice. Any injustice. Imagine if you say, La ilaha illallah, Muhammadun Rasulullah, and you smile at me and I don't smile back, that's an injustice. So the companions came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they said, Ya Rasulallah, wa ayyuna la ya'ti bi dhulmin? Who amongst us does not indulge into injustice? Yeah, we all do. The Prophet said to him, is not the injustice you're talking about. Is the injustice the wise man asked his son not to indulge in? Ya bunayya la tushrik billah, inna ash-shirka la zulmun azim. My son, never associate others in worship with Allah. Indeed, this is an absolute form of injustice. Shirk. Imagine, brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah is saying, those who believe, those who have tawheed, but what did they do? They tarnished their tawheed with shirk. Committing a form of injustice. How do you do that? You associate others in worship with Allah. You believe Allah is the creator, the sustainer, the provider. You believe that. But somehow, you still give powers to created beings. You negate Allah's ability to help you. You begin entertaining that someone else can help you. That can be an amulet. That can be the five thing that you hang on the wall. That can be the fortune teller. But in the case, we're talking about dead people here, brothers and sisters in Islam. So that's where I got the word, the ultimate injustice. Right here. My son, join not in worship others with Allah. Verily, joining others in worship with Allah is a great zulm, injustice. Why grave worship is a great injustice? Very simple, brothers and sisters in Islam. Very simple. Allah said in the Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created jinn kind or mankind but to worship me. Clear? طيب. What is worship? What is worship? Right here. Anything. 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 That would include Salah, Zakah, Hajj, recitation of the Quran, reverence, hope, fear, love. They categorize acts of worship with associating it with the limbs. So, هناك العبادات القلبية, the acts of worship which is associated with the heart. That would include what? Sincerity. When you call upon Allah, you call upon Him without any, you're not showing off, you're not wanting the dunya because of what you're doing, you're not wanting money. تعس عبد الدينار, تعس عبد الدرهم. تعس عبد الخميصة, like the Prophet said. So, intention, sincerity. You do it because you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because He created you. He wants you to do the right thing for you. And He want to give you Jannah. You do it also because you're afraid of His punishment. Fear. But again, the fear which does not incite you or drive you to despair, but the fear which takes you to work. It's exactly, brothers and sisters in Islam, if I tell you There is a thief in town tonight who's about to steal your houses. Some people go, oh, my house is going to be stolen. And what I'm going to do is going to kill me. Despair. And another guy will say, okay, how can I protect myself from the thief? Go to locksmith. Okay. Allah will punish you if you don't pray. Oh, Allah is going to punish me. I'm going to go to hell. It's not me, hopefully. No, I'm going to pray so I don't go to hell. Fear. Like also love and hope. There is also hope. The hope. A lot of Muslims, unfortunately, they bank too much on hope. Inna Allah, he doesn't pray five times a day. Inna Allah ghafoorun raheem. Allah forgives. They say that. Allah forgives. He's indulged. He's engaged in sins from head to toe. Inna Allah ghafoorun raheem. La, hada irja. The other one, the despair, is al-Khawarij, al-Murja'a wal-Khawarij, two sects. Ahlul Sunnah wal-Jama'a in the middle, brothers and sisters in Islam. Reliance upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, hope in Allah. So this is the heart. And everything, every act that you do has to come from the heart. Have to come from your tasdeeq. Then there is the tongue. There is the tongue. You know, the recitation of the Quran. Saying, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, Ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah. And all of that. Enjoining good and forbidding evil. Saying, Assalamu alaikum. Then the limbs. You know, the salah. Then the financial, going to Hajj. Now, look at the grave worshipper. What does he do? When he goes to the grave, he has reverence to the engraved. And that reverence should be Allah's. Exclusively. He will converse with him, with the deceased. Ya Jilani, Ya Tijani, Ya Rifa'i, help me. And furthermore, he may actually slaughter. He may go and touch the grave like this, tabarruk, something that you should do to the Kaaba, to the black stone only. He may slaughter on behalf of the deceased. Huh? He may do tawaf around the grave, which should be done exclusively in the Kaaba. Allahu Akbar. So how in the world you tell me that someone who goes to the grave doesn't associate the engraved with Allah? Logically doesn't make any sense, brothers and sisters in Islam. Nu'man ibn Bashir radiyallahu anhuma narrated that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Ad-du'a'u huwa al-ibadah. Ad-du'a is the essence of ibadah. Why, brothers and sisters in Islam? I always say this. Because you show humility. You see, the higher aim of ibadah, of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to do what? Is to break. Is to humble yourself before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the higher aim, by the way. Look at the position of salah when you place the forehead in the ground. Look at Hajj when the people are standing on the mountain of Arafah and wearing izar and rida. Huh? Look at the rich person when he goes and he gives to the poor. Huh? I'm like you. I just, Allah has blessed me with some wealth and I'm sharing it with you. And I'm following Allah's commands. Look at fasting. What fasting does, you're going to experience that tomorrow, just tomorrow. What fasting will do to you towards the end of the day. سبحان الله دعاء can do this. يا رب يا رب يا رب. You see that? Many people, by the way, perform the acts of worship, but they do not generate that breakage, that breaking down, that humility. No. Now, brothers and sisters in Islam, you go in front of someone who is dead. Ya Rifa'i, Ya Tijani, help me. Allahu Akbar. And you want to tell me that it's not shirk? There is something wrong with you, quite frankly, and you don't make any sense at all. طيب. The last thing I want to share with you tonight, brothers and sisters in Islam, as we get ready for Taraweeh. There is something out there that can justify the grave worshippers. Do grave worshippers have any reason to justify their heinous act, which is the ultimate injustice? Why do they need to go to these shrines and perform rituals which are exclusive to Allah when they can call upon Allah directly? Does Allah need someone in between Him, Subhana, and us? The companions, brothers and sisters in Islam, came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam فيما أخرج ابن جرير الطبري في تفسير قوله تعالى in explaining وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ. The companions asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, يا رسول الله, O Messenger of Allah, أقريب ربنا فنناجيه أم بعيد فنناديه. Is my Lord, is our Lord near us, so we call upon Him in secret, المناجاة. يا رب خلي يا رب خلي يا رب ارحمني يا رب. Or He is far off, سبحانه, so we should call upon Him. We should yell. We should call upon him loudly. Subhanallah. Jibra'il alayhi salam came with the answer. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي لَعَلَّهُمْ يَرْشُدُونَ.
If they ask you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my slaves, if they ask you about me, you know, so many places in the Quran, 16 almost, they ask you, and always the answer is what? قل, say. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would convey the answer to the Prophet to convey it by his turn to the companions. This one, no. Inni, Allah said, I am near. And brothers and sisters in Islam, al-qurbu, al-qurb, the nearness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Allah knows, Allah sees everything. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above the throne in a way that suits His majesty. That is why we say, عُلُوهُ لَا يُنَافِي قُرْبَهُ. His highness, His being above the throne, does not negate His nearness. He's still near us, brothers and sisters in Islam. He's still near us, brothers and sisters in Islam. And subhanallah, to your surprise, that this particular verse is one of the five verses of Surah Al-Baqarah where Allah spoke about fasting. Actually, Allah spoke about fasting in 5 verses in Surah Al-Baqarah. This happened to be one of them, brothers and sisters in Islam, this particular verse. A lot of the scholars, they said, this is associated with fasting. And they brought in Hadith al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, 3 individuals, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not reject their dua. ثلاث لا يرد دعوتهم أو لا ترد دعوتهم. One of the 3, والصائم حين يفطر والصائم حتى يفطر. The fasting person until he breaks his fast. Another wording, the fasting person when he breaks his fast, the time of breaking the fast. Why the grave worshiper needs to go to a cemetery somewhere where, why do you need that? You know, why do you need that, dear grave worshiper? Why, brothers and sisters and sisters? When you have Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you can call upon him at any time. So this is number one. Number two, brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah is never absent. You know, subhanAllah, you know, when you call upon created beings, you have to make sure that they hear you. You have to make sure that they listen to you. You know, you have to make sure they are awake. Imagine those people, they go to someone who is what? Who is dead. You don't know whether he is alive or not, brothers and sisters in Islam. Hadith Abi Musa al-Ash'ari, رضي الله عنه, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم, one day he was traveling with his companions, the hadith in Sahih Imam al-Bukhari, and the companions, you know the sunnah that when you go up the hill, Allahu Akbar, when you go down, Subhanallah, Allahu Akbar, so they used to say, Allahu Akbar, Subhanallah. Then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to them, اغبعوا على أنفسكم. Chill. Down a little bit. فإنكم لا تدعون أصما ولا غائبا. You're not calling upon someone who cannot hear you, nor you're calling upon someone who's absent. So how dare you, grave worshipper, compare someone who you do not even know? And I intentionally place this right after the last lecture. Please go and watch the last lecture, because we discussed this question, can the deceased hear us? Brothers and sisters in Islam, I don't care who amongst the mashayikh says they hear us. I tell you, show me definite evidence. This is a subject, yes, scholars differed upon, right? Even those who said they do hear us, but they cannot help you. سمع الذي ليس له فائدة ولا المتكلم فائدة, they say. The scholars who said they hear, they said, you talking to them is not going to benefit them unless Allah wills. You making dua for them is not going to benefit them unless Allah wills, and they cannot help you. إن تدعوهم لا يسمعوا دعاءكم ولو سمعوا ما استجابوا لكم ويوم القيامة يكفرون بشرككم ولا ينبئك مثل خبير. If you call upon them, they cannot hear you. But what if they hear you? إِنْ تَدْعُوهُمْ لَا يَسْمَعُوا وَإِنْ سَمِعُوا لَا يَسْتَجِيبُوا لَكُمْ. They cannot help you. And they, in the day of judgment, they will disown you. وَمَنْ أَضَلُّ مِمَّنْ يَدْعُوا مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ مَنْ لَا يَسْتَجِيبُ لَهُ إِلَى يَوْمِ الْقِيَامَةِ وَهُمْ عَنْ دُعَائِهِمْ غَافِلُونَ. وَإِذَا حُشِرَ النَّاسُ كَانُوا لَهُمْ أَعْدَاءً وَكَانُوا بِعْبَادَتِهِمْ كَافِرِينَ. Who is more misguided than someone who calls upon someone who cannot even answer him until the day of judgment? And on the day of judgment, they will disown you. Al-Jilani, by the way, I heard he's a very righteous, pious person. He's going to disown many people, like Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. He's going to disown many, many, many people. أَأَنْتَ قُلْتَ لِلنَّاسِ اتَّخِذُونِي وَأُمِّيَ إِلَهَيْنِ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ قَالَ سُبْحَانَكَ مَا يَكُونُ لِي أَنْ أَقُولَ مَا لَيْسَ لِي بِحَقَّ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is their brothers and sisters in Islam. We may ask Allah for anything, subhanallah. We may ask Allah for anything. Ya ikhwa, there is a hadith, Abi Dharr al-Ghifari radiallahu anhu, and the hadith, I compiled it in the piece of work I'm working on, inshallah, in response to this grave worship plunder. Ya ibadi, my slave, kullukum ja'i'un illa man at'amta, illa man at'amtu, fastat'imuni ut'imkum. My slaves, all of you are hungry, except those who ask for food. I will give them food. Ya ibadi, all of you are naked. All of you are misguided. Anything that you want from Allah, brothers and sisters in Islam, they can ask Allah for anything. My slaves, if the first of you and the last of you would stand in one barren place, in one even place, and each one of you would ask me something, I will give you what you ask for without decreasing anything from what I owe. Again, I think the point I'm trying to make, brothers and sisters, Islam, is crystal clear that we do not need people to Allah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Caller, can you hear us?
Yeah, I can hear.
Okay, name, state, and question, please.
My name is Umar, I'm from India. Sheikh, my question is, in the beginning of month of Ramadan, we will be very active, like this is the month of Ramadan to do good deeds. But as we move forward, like 10, after 10 days, 15 days, that spirit becomes low. How to maintain that whole spirit in the month of Ramadan and the task?
I would recommend for the brother is asking a very good question, by the way, which many Muslims, they call it quit, you know, right, when they you know, after a week or so. How can you maintain?
Yeah, how can we maintain that spirit?
The spirit of praying Taraweeh and all of that. A lot of work needed to be done. Brother, I'll answer you, inshallah. A lot of work needed to be done before. Now, this work is not done. So I advise the brothers to take it easy. You know, the first week, the second week, just build up. Because, you see, that's why Rajab was there, Sha'ban was there, for you to build up a momentum. To build up a momentum for this particular, month. But a lot of Muslims, unfortunately, they failed to do that, brothers and sisters in Islam. Then they have to build that momentum in Ramadan. So I wouldn't advise you to go hard on yourself the first week. Just base yourself a little bit and build up from there, inshallah. This is the advice that I have for the brothers, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. Brothers, you can call us now, 303-500-5101. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Caller, you're live. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Let me see here. Can you hear me? Somehow the caller is gone. Okay. Okay, let me see if we can pick him up again. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Hello?
Yeah, caller, you're live. Can you hear me?
Assalamu alaikum.
Alaykum as-salam. Can you hear me?
Hello?
Yeah, somehow we're having an issue with the regular calling. As-salamu alaykum.
Alaykum
as-salam.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Caller,
are you there?
No, as-salamu alaykum.
Alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Can you turn down the TV, please?
Yes, yes, Imam.
Okay, go ahead.
Imam, I want to know what is the difference between Taraweeh and Tahajjud. Are they the same or there is a difference?
That's a very good question. A lot of the brothers and the sisters, they are confused regarding Taraweeh and Tahajjud. Brothers and sisters in Islam, the Salah which we observe at night, it can be called Salatul Layl, Qiyamul Layl, Salatul Tahajjud. In Ramadan, we call it Salatul Taraweeh. Only in Ramadan. Taraweeh is exclusive to Ramadan. That you're allowed to have a congregation to pray night Salah. You're only allowed to do this in Ramadan in the masjid. In your house, you're allowed to do this with your family only. And if you have a guest and who joins you accidentally, like I believe Ibn Abbas did with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Regarding the family, hadith Abi Hurairah fi Sunan Abi Dawud, rahimallahu rajulan قام من الليل فصلى ثم أيقظ أهله. Allah will have mercy on a man who would wake up at night to observe tahajjud, and then he would wake up his wife. Other than that, you know, there are some people who actually establish jama'ah in the masjid for night salah outside of Ramadan. Bid'ah ما أنزل الله بها من سلطان. The only time you're allowed to do this is during the month of Ramadan. And this is called Taraweeh. Jazakallahu khairan.
Okay, walaikum
assalam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Caller, are you there?
No, it's the same one.
I heard another call, but somehow the other line.
Can you share?
Oh, can you hear me now? Yeah. Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? Can you hear me?
Hello, assalamu alaikum.
Can you hear me?
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
Okay. Assalamu alaikum.
Can you hear me? Hello, assalamu alaikum. Can you hear me?
Ismail. That's Ismail, right? Okay. Somehow we're having an issue here with the other phone lines. So it's either that or that. Alhamdulillah. Okay, our own nafs, which is evil. Okay, let me see it. Okay, salam alaikum. Ismail, can you hear me?
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh. When I call you from the regular line, no, I cannot hear you.
Yeah, I don't know why. It's either this or that, you know. Subhanallah. Is it?
Yeah.
Can you hear me now, so?
Yes, Sheikh. Now I can hear you, but not from the regular phone. No.
Maybe we just
the WhatsApp
need.
Call.
We just need to take WhatsApp calls. What do you think about that?
Yeah, Sheikh. If I may ask a question.
Sure, go ahead.
Sheikh, and I'm sorry, maybe it's a repetitive question you probably have answered before. Is there a sunnah for Salatul Tawbah? If the answer is yes, then I can ask my second question, Sheikh.
No, I'm not aware of any. There is a hadith which the people use as the reference, that whoever makes wudu and, offer two rak'ahs, where in these two rak'ahs, he does not, think about other things but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah will forgive his sins. That's all we know. Now, if you want to use that as an evidence, but you shouldn't call that Salah, Salatul Tawbah. Basically, you pray two rak'ahs, you make wudu, you pray two rak'ahs, that's unrestricted tanafkhul. You see, when you give it a name, Brother Ismail, you have made it restricted. And that name doesn't exist. You're getting that. Like tahiyyatul masjid. Answer me. Is tahiyyatul masjid tanafful mutlaq or tanafful muqayyad? Is restricted nafila or unrestricted nafila? What is the answer? Restricted. That you come to the masjid and you make wudu, and before you sit down, you pray two rak'ahs. So it's restricted, it has. Now, if you're going to give this tawbah, number one, we don't have an evidence for it. You're getting me. And yes. Now you're going to associate it with what? With sins. That you committed a sin and you want Allah to forgive it. And there is no such a thing. And that's where I stand on this issue.
One more question, if I may.
Sure.
If somebody has multiple major sins, doing tawbah for all of them once is sufficient, or
no.
Should you make
you see that's the particulars of major sins, dear brothers and sisters in Islam, is you cannot do a package deal. You see, saying astaghfirullah for many sins, it's permissible. And also, you know, like Ramadan, until sunset tonight, inshallah, Allah will forgive. If you already reach sunset, all your minor is gone. وَرَمَضَانُ إِلَى رَمَضَانُ From Ramadan until the next Ramadan. But the hadith says, إِذَا مَجْتُنِبَتِ الْكَبَائِرِ As long as you avoid major sins. Now, what do you have to do about major sins? There are two pillars which you cannot compromise once it comes to major sins. One of them is regretting, remorsing. Man, why did I do this? Astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. There is no way you will generate regretfulness if you don't identify what you've done. How are you gonna generate that regretfulness, that remorse, if you don't associate it with a certain act, a major sin? Add to this, if you look at the majority of the major sins, has to do with the rights of others. Is you return the rights, whether it is material rights or moral rights. You're getting that. So there is no such a thing called package deal once it comes to repenting from sins. Jazakallahu khairan, Ismail. Ahsanallahu ilayk. Sisters in Islam, I think we're doing okay, inshallah. We just have to look into that sound with the other regular phone line, but you can always call in WhatsApp, inshallah. If this is okay with you. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaikum. Caller, you're live. Assalamu alaikum. Caller, you're live. Can you speak up, please?
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Name and where you calling from, please?
This is Brother Ibrahim from Kampala.
From Kampala, where is that Kampala? Is that Rwanda?
Uganda.
Huh?
No, Uganda.
Uganda. Yes. How are you doing?
Alhamdulillah.
They tell you Rwanda is one of the most progressive African nations now, I heard. Is that correct?
Naam.
MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. How is Islam there?
Alhamdulillah, we are trying, Sheikh.
نسأل الله أن يبارك فيكم يا رب العالمين. How can I help you?
Sheikh, I'm asking about Taraweeh. Is it 11 or we can go above 11?
Is it what again?
Is it 11 raka? 11 and 13 or we can go above 11 and 13?
Oh, brothers and sisters in Islam, regarding the subject of Taraweeh and how many rak'az, listen, حديث عائشة رضي الله عنها عمدة في هذا الباب. The hadith of Aisha is the main source regarding this particular question. Rasulullah, she said, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam never prayed over 11 rak'ahs, whether in Ramadan or outside Ramadan. The only time we know that Aisha radiallahu anha was not around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the last night of Ramadan. Why the last night of Ramadan? Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do i'tikaf in the masjid. So, and he said, when the last nights of the month are here, make sure that you keep your nights alive. وَأَحْيَا لَيْلَةً, that you're always awake at night and praying and so forth. So you may add the last, and that is why we have the tradition or the sunnah of adding tahajjud. So taraweeh at the beginning of the night and tahajjud the last, and that's where we find the permissibility to do that. Brothers and sisters in Islam. Now, if someone chooses to pray 20 or 22 or whatever, some 36, we're not going to say, you know, we're not going to offend them and say it's bid'ah and all of that. I wouldn't say that, but I would stick to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is 11 rak'ahs, the first 20 nights, and you may add the last 10 nights of the month. Jazakallahu khaira, barakallahu fiik, ahsanallahu ilayk. Okay, I don't know if our time is up or not, but we had some time here with the... Give us a call, brothers and sisters in Islam. It's the WhatsApp number, 303-500-5101. It's a WhatsApp number. You can call us from any place in the world, actually. It's a WhatsApp number, so we can take your phone call. Bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Okay, let me see here. Okay, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum. Assalamu alaikum. Naam, name, state, and question, please.
My name is Farooq. I'm from India.
MashaAllah, a lot of brothers. What time is in India now, Farooq? What time is it in India now?
It's 6:30.
In the morning?
Yeah, morning.
Oh, okay, MashaAllah. You're fasting today or no?
No, we are fasting tomorrow.
Oh, so today is what day?
Today is Tuesday.
Oh, so you're not beginning Tuesday, you're beginning Wednesday. Okay, okay, got you.
Yeah.
All right, inshallah. What is your question?
My question is, the promise which Allah made to protect Quran is of the Quran which is at Luhe Mahfuz, or the Quran which we will read daily?
So the Quran which what now?
Yeah.
So Allah...
The Quran which is at Luhe Mahfuz, or the Quran which we are reading today?
Both. Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidun. Farooq, I would love for you to understand the context of this verse. Look at the verse. Do you have a mushaf in front of you? Look at the verse before it. What does the verse before it say? وَقَالُوا يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِي نُزِّلَ عَلَيْهِ الذِّكْرُ إِنَّكَ لَمَجْنُونَ لَوْ مَا تَأْتِيْنَا بِالْمَلَائِكَةِ إِن كُنْتَ مِنَ الصَّادِقِينَ مَا نُنَزِّلُ الْمَلَائِكَةَ إِلَّا بِالْحَقِّ وَمَا كَانُوا إِذًا مُنْظَرِينَ إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. The disbelievers of Mecca are asking the Prophet, instead of the Quran, can you bring down the angels so that we can believe you? So Allah is saying to them, the only time I bring down the angels is to destroy you. And when angels come down, you're not going to be given a second chance. Now we know in other places of the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I don't want to show them sign, miracle, physical sign, because if they reject it, I will destroy them. And I don't want to destroy them while you're alive. Now, instead of that, I brought down a dhikr, and I will preserve it to be an evidence against them. How Allah will preserve the Quran? Allah will preserve it. When it came down min al-lawh al-mahfuz to the lower heaven, the moment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he disallowed the shayateen to spy, to eardrop on the lower heaven. وَأَنَّا كُنَّا نَقْعُدُ مِنْهَا مَقَاعِدَ لِلسَّمَّ فَمَنْ يَسْتَمِعِ الْآنَ يَجِدْ لَهُ شِهَابًا رَصَدًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala trusted his mighty angel Jibreel with the communication, and now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he used to recite it, when Jibreel would recite to him the Quran, he would repeat to him, إِنَّ عَلَيْنَا جَمْعَهُ وَقُرْآنَ فَلَا تَعْجَلْ بِالْقُرْآنِ مِنْ قَبْلِ أَنْ يُلْقَى إِلَيْكَ وَحْيُهُ وَقُلْ رَبِّ زِدْنِي عِلْمًا. Don't be afraid. We'll remind you. سَنُقْرِئُكَ فَلَا تَنْسَى. You will not forget. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also employed others than the angels and the messengers to protect his guidance. The companions who used to write it, memorize it. Many memorized it. And Allah appointed Abu Bakr to compile it in one book, and Uthman to bring this book and distribute it around the Ummah. And the Quran is memorized by children. Can't you see that this applies to the actual Quran which we have in our own hands? Can't you see that, Farooq? I mean,
yes.
You go and read in the masjid, and make one mistake, one letter, and see how many people are going to correct you. Both, ya akhi. With sunnah, by the way, and the sunnah too. Jazakallahu khairan, Farooq. Barakallahu fi.
Sheikh.
Now.
I was confused. The old scriptures, how they were manipulated, and how the Quran will be protected.
You see, the old scripture, Farooq, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the scholars to preserve it. اللي هو الايه؟ الامر الشرعي. Like, لا إله إلا الله. Like, would you like to be a Muslim or not? With the Quran, كوني. It's qadr. Allah ordained for the Quran to be preserved. Done. It's not subject to us. If the whole world would gather to change the Quran, they can't. They cannot. Why? Because it's Amr Qadari. You need to understand this. The actions of Allah, when He commands us to do something, some of them are shar'i. Shar'i meaning what? You have a choice. It's like pray five times a day. Is it shar'i or qadari? Is it your qadr to pray five times a day? Or it is a command from Allah that you have a choice to do? You have a choice. Shar'i, do not do, up to you. Now, Amr Qadari, like, leave the Quran alone, like, where were you born? When were you born? Why are you born in India, not in America? Why are you not in America here? Because that's Qadar. Your parents, Qadar. How long you live, Qadar. Your rizq, Qadar. You're getting that. Amr Qadri, Jazakallahu khairan, Farooq, Barakallahu feek.
Jazakallah.
And sisters in Islam, I have to get ready for Maghrib here, inshallah. Someone else calling. Okay, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi. This call, Ismail, and then I'll be done. So, wa alaikum assalam. Name, state, and question, please.
My name is Abdullah. I'm calling from Canada.
Mm-hmm.
I just wanted to say Ramadan Mubarak.
Ramadan Mubarak to you,
Abdullah. May Allah bless you. May Allah shower His blessings upon you.
Ameen.
And may Allah shower His blessings upon the Muslim Ummah.
Ameen. 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 Jazakallahu khairan, Abdullah. Ahsan Allahu ilayhi. Ramadan Mubarak to all of you, dear brothers. Ramadan Mubarak. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu
alaikum. Wa alaikum. Ramadan Mubarak to all of you guys. Inshallah, I have to go for Taraweeh. It's the first night. Inshallah, we'll broadcast it live. If you're somewhere else in a different time zone, you can watch it, inshallah. I love you all for the sake of Allah. Subhanakallah wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والحمد لله رب العالمين.
فت فؤادك الأيام فتى وتنحت جسمك الساعات نحتى وتدعوك المنون دعاء صدق ألا يا صاح أنت أريد أنت أراك تحب عرسا ذات خدر أبت طلاقها الأكياس بتى تنام الدهر ويحك في غطيط بها حتى إذا مت انتبهتا فكم ذا أنت مخدوع وحتى متى لا ترعوي عنها وحتى أبا بكر دعوتك لو أجبتا إلى ما فيه حظك لو عقلتا إلى علم تكون به إماما مطاعا إن نهيت وإن أمرتا ويجلو ما بعينك من غشاها ويهديك السبيل إذا ضللتا وتحمل منه في ناديك.